All right, so it was a Sunday morning, 2014, January. We were at 20 Mission. I was just setting up coffee. It was around 9 a.m. A man walked in with a tight leather jacket and a helmet. And he said, "Hi, I just flew in from Tokyo." I'm like, "Wow, welcome to SF Bitcoin Devs. You're first." And he's like, "Yeah, I quit my PhD to come work in Bitcoin, and I heard your meetup is the best." And I was like, "Well, who are you?" I'm like, "What do you do?" He's like, "I'm nobody. I'm just, you know, a kind of guy. I just wanted to help out." And, 4 years later, this guy is now one of the lead scientists at the MIT Digital Currency Initiative. He's also the co-founder of Lightning, which, if you don't know Lightning, everybody's looking to fork it. He's also the co-founder of Ethereum Dagger Hashimoto. Anybody remember Dagger Hashimoto? Wow, I'm a really old guy. All right, proof of work based on Ethereum. So a lot of what Ethereum is driving has been built by this guy, and you may not know. So Tadge, we begged him to come talk to us. He has a lot of stuff he wants to present. So he's going to present on one presentation here, Discreet Log Contracts, right? Am I talking about it? Discreet Log Contracts, yeah. And I saw this at the Bitcoin MIT Expo. It was an awesome presentation. I asked him to do it again. He will have other presentations, so we'll bring him back. But please, if you would join me in giving a warm, awesome welcome to Tadge, Dryja. There you go.
Okay, yes. Suspicious work on the Discreet Log Contracts. Okay, so, hello everyone. Tarek already introduced me, but I'm Tadge Dryja. I work at MIT right now, at the Digital Currency Initiative, which is really cool. Actually, it's not on the slide, but I'm teaching a class at MIT right now for undergrads and grad students about Bitcoin, cryptocurrencies, this kind of stuff. And the idea is to have most of it online. So right now all the slides are online and the homeworks are online. And we're going to put the videos of me talking and other people talking online. Not everyone, because a lot of people, guest speakers, didn't want to have videos because of NDAs and stuff. But there's a lot of it online. So if you look at github.com/MIT-DCI, there's the class and there's a lot of materials if you're interested in it. It's kind of cool because I get mails from people in other countries sometimes being like, "Hey, you forgot to put up the slides this week." I'm like, "Oh, shoot, I did." So it's cool that people are looking at it. I wrote Lightning Network, Joseph Poon, and we presented that about 3 years ago at something else Tarek was posting, so pretty cool. And so this is newer work called Discreet Log Contracts. There's another, I'm working on this a lot at MIT now, and working on some other, so MIT's cool, but there's like too many things going on, so I need to like... But hopefully I'll have another paper or two in the coming year, coming summer, I think. Okay, so super sort of little bit of review or like, you know, what's the problem we're dealing with here? So scalability is sort of a perennial problem in all of these systems. Every transaction going on the blockchain doesn't really scale well. It's sort of O of n squared, not really. O of n squared, if you count n squared is like, n is like all the transactions on all the computers, but as a single computer as yourself, it's O of n, but still. Anyway, so just to review the first response that anyone ever said about Bitcoin, I think people know what it is, right? Don, whatever. So Satoshi, November 2008, "I've been working on a new electronic cash system that's fully peer-to-peer with no trusted third party. First person who ever responded to Satoshi on the mailing list, whoever this guy is, James A. Donald, we very, very much need such a system, but the way I understand your proposal, it does not seem to scale to the required size." So, the first thing anyone ever said about Bitcoin was it doesn't scale. And they were quite correct. I mean, you know, so that now we're sort of living that through.
And then John Gilmore complained about the energy wastage.
Well, yeah, energy scale. So the problems we argue about today are nothing new. These were from the get-go. This is November, so this is a couple months before Bitcoin even was released. This is just a paper. And so today, if you go into your .bitcoin folder and you view .h, this is with TXID index on, but actually, and it's also a few months ago, so it's probably about the same even with it off right now. It's about 190 gigs. The state is, you know, the actual UTXO set's only about 3.5 to 4 gigs. But still, you gotta slog through a good 180 gigs to get there. It's big. It's a problem because a lot of people don't run full nodes and they just use, you know, some website or something, some kind of SPV thing, or don't even have their own keys and let a different company or website do that for them. And a big reason why is This is huge. This is not non-trivial to deal with. So, a long time ago, 2012, I think, Mike Hearn and Matt and some people were looking at one-way channels, where you have some kind of incremental payment channel. And so from the beginning in Bitcoin, transactions have a 4-byte lock time field. So similar to a check, if you date a check, it's not valid before that date, but it is valid after. So a transaction's going to be valid after the lock time. And you can do height or Unix time. I think most of the people use height. I use it in my code. It just feels more Bitcoin-y. And then you can have these one-way channels where Alice and Bob both send money to a 2-of-2 multi-sig. And then, so let's say Alice sends money to Alice and Bob's 2-of-2. And then what Alice can do is sign a transaction like this and hand the signature over to Bob. And Bob knows that this is just as good as getting paid, which is kind of cool, because Bob says, well, I've got a transaction where Alice gets 9 coins and I get 1. Alice has signed it, and I haven't done anything. I've just received the signature. That's the equivalent to me getting paid a coin, because I know Alice can't do anything with this, right? Alice would have to ask me to sign something. And I've got Alice's signature. Alice doesn't have mine. I can just attach my own signature to this whenever I feel like it and get a coin. So it's just as good as having that coin outright. Not quite as good, because it's a little annoying, because you have to sign and then broadcast this and then spend it to where you want it to go. But trust-wise, it's just as good. So Bob says, okay, I've got the coin. Bob doesn't broadcast this, however. He just leaves this on his hard drive and then waits. And then the next day, Alice says, okay, here, now you have 2 coins and I get 8. Alice gives Bob the signature for this. Bob holds on to it. What's also interesting, Bob at this point can delete the signature for this one, because this is strictly better, right? Bob would not want to broadcast this if he has the option to broadcast this, because Bob wants 2 coins more than he wants 1 coin. And you can keep doing this. You can't keep doing it forever, though, right? You can keep doing it till, well, Bob has all the money. And also in these payment channels, to prevent Bob from just locking up the money indefinitely, you'll usually have some kind of other time lock transaction where Alice gets all the money back after a week or two. So Bob has some kind of time pressure here. So this is cool, but it never really took off. I think there were some implementations, but there were security problems with funding, which, malleability. And also, it's fundamentally one way, and you can't do that much with it. So, you update it lots of times. You don't tell the network about the state. You broadcast the most recent state to close. But now, the idea is you want to be able to revoke old states. So if you want to go the other way, so let's say you get to here, and Bob says, hey, Alice, I want to pay you now. Let's go back to here, where I have 1 coin. So I want to pay you 2 coins. Bob can give Alice a signature for this transaction. But it's not a credible thing, right? Alice knows Bob still got this transaction and this signature, and he can broadcast it whenever he wants. So what Bob wants to be able to do is to tell Alice, I deleted it. I deleted this signature, and here's one for this, so don't worry, this is the only one we can broadcast. But you can't prove you deleted something. That's not even cryptography, that's just you can't prove you forgot. But what you can do is you can revoke old states by revealing instead of deleting. So what if your script was like this? And this is the script. Well, condense these. But basically you're saying, okay, key A and key B, or key C and 100 blocks. So these two people sign, these two keys sign, or this other single key signs after a certain period of time. So A, key A and key B together can spend at any time. Key C can spend, but they have to wait. So if you have both keys A and B, you can grab the coins first. And this is how you revoke transactions in Lightning, right? So the idea is, okay, well, if this is Alice's, let's say this is Carol's coins, and I should have used different letters. This is Carol's coins, but she has to wait. But she can give Alice, she can revoke it to Alice by giving Alice this key. This is Alice's key, this is the one Carol came up with and reveals. So in the practice in Lightning channels, Alice gives Bob Alice's revocation key, Bob gives Alice Bob revocation private key. Now if they broadcast an old state, they lose all their money, right? Their counterparty can immediately take all the funds, whereas they have to wait. So this is a nice mechanism where, okay, you can now go multi-directional, you can go back and forth as many times as you want. You've got the same funding process. You make a transaction, you make a new transaction, so in this case, Bob is paying Alice 4 coins. And then Bob retracts this and said, okay, I haven't forgotten anything, but I've given you the key to these 9 coins. And Alice says, okay, Bob, I've given you the key to this 1 coin. So if Alice broadcasts this, she loses everything. If Bob broadcasts this, he loses everything. And now this is the only valid one. And then you build the next channel, the next channel state, and revoke the old one. So there is a period of time, briefly, where they're both sort of valid. You just don't consider the payment final until everything's revoked, except the most current one. So this is how Lightning works. This is implemented. And then Lightning has multi-hop and all these other things. But the basic the basic script is, okay, you've got this revocable key that can be spent immediately, or this other key that takes time. And actually, in the script, you can condense these. I'll go into some more fun elliptic curve math in like a few minutes, but 2 of 2 multi-sig in some ways, if it's the case where you're revealing a private key, you can condense these two, because you can just say key A plus key B and sum the public keys, and then the sum of the private keys will be able to sign with that. So I'll go into that in a second. Okay, so this is the mechanism for Lightning. Everyone's cool with this? Okay. And then what if you want to do something else with this? So like conditional payments. Payments conditional on some external data, which is a very nice way. It's a very broad technical way of saying it, but it's also, you could say, like gambling or betting. And so you could say, if someone's betting on a baseball game, you could say, well, we're making payments conditional on real-world outcomes. Sounds very technical. Or you can also take things that people think of as legit, like health insurance, and you could just say, well, that's just gambling, right? I'm just betting I'm going to get really sick. And if I get really sick, I win, and they have to pay me a lot. And like car insurance, I bet I'm going to crash my car, and then they're like, I bet you won't, and they're like, I crashed it, pay up. So different ways to think. But so the thing is, like all of finance, not all, but almost all of finance is like basically conditional payment. If this happens, money goes over here. If this other thing happens, money moves this way. So this is fairly general, but I'm going to give a concrete example where Alice and Bob are betting on the weather tomorrow. So if it rains, Alice gets a coin. If it's sunny, Bob gets a coin. I might switch. I always get them confused, and maybe I'll say Bob gets it if it's raining. But anyway, one gets, sunny versus rain. So the problem is there's no op weather. You can't have the blockchain tell you what the weather is, right? That'd be nice, but that's probably not going to get software in anytime soon. So you've got this Lightning Network simple script where it just enforces the most recent thing. And this is a smart contract. I would say that Lightning uses a smart contract. It's a really simple one, but it's, saying, hey, this key signs, or after a certain period of time, this other key signs. Pretty simple, but lets you do lots of cool stuff. The difference here is, in Lightning, the state of the smart contract is sort of closed loop, in that, okay, it's not going to fall. The state is all internal, in that, Alice is paying Bob, and maybe there's another party, Carol, everyone's paying each other, but there's no, external real-world data. All the data that's getting generated is getting generated by the people in the channels and on the network. And most of it's like random numbers. Like, oh, I'm going to reveal some random number, which then lets me spend this, or things like that. But in the case of the weather, it's in some ways random, and you don't know what the weather is going to be tomorrow, but it's a real-world thing, right? It's external state that you want to get into your contract. So if you want external state, you need some way to get it into the blockchain, into this network. And we usually refer to that as an oracle. So the simplest system for an oracle we think of is like 2 of 3 multisig. Actually, even simpler, 2 of 2 multisig, where you just say, okay, Alice and Bob just put their money in a 2 of 2 multisig address, and then they shake hands, and if it's sunny, Alice signs and says, okay, Bob, you get all the money, and if it's rainy, Bob signs and says, okay, Alice, you win. The problem there is that if there's a conflict, and Alice says, dude, it totally wasn't raining at all. That was not rain. That was, not even a drop. And Bob's like, no, that counted as rain. I felt it. Then they're stuck, right? Now it's 2 of 2 multisig. They don't agree. You could be stuck indefinitely. And it also gives an advantage to rich players in systems like this, because let's say Bob's a millionaire, and Alice is trying to make rent, and Alice is like, look, I really need the money. I think I won, but I'm more willing to compromise, right? Let's split it 50-50. And Bob's like, okay, cool, 50-50. And even though Bob sort of knows he lost, and that's kind of scummy, but, you know, the people who have a lower time value of money are at an advantage here because they can wait out. They can also do things where that's like not even as interactive, where, you know, it could rain. I keep forgetting which is rain. Anyway, it can rain, and Bob can say, hey, look, I know it rained, right? But I'm a jerk, and this is an anonymous, trustless, decentralized system. I'm going to give you a few dozen time-locked signed transactions. The one that is valid right now gives you 0.1 points and gives me 0.9. One that's valid tomorrow gives you a little more. And then eventually you'll get almost all your money back, and I'll get a very small amount. But you'll have to wait a year. So you pick, right? And the only real response Alice can make to that is another similar response with even longer timeouts. So hoping that Bob will break first and broadcast something. So you do need some kind of third-party arbitration, some kind of oracle. So yeah, two works great with friends, but Bitcoin is the currency of enemies, and third party can decide. So you could do this. You could have Olivia. Look like an LMI font. So three keys. You've got Alice's key, Bob's key, and Olivia's key. If Alice and Bob are chill and they agree, yep, it totally rained, okay, we'll send all the money over. And they can both sign without getting Olivia involved, which is nice, right? So this is an optimistic protocol where they don't, you know, they only fall back to Olivia in the case where a conflict occurs. And if they do fight, or way more likely than fighting, one of them just disappears, right? So Bob's just gone. Maybe he figures he lost the bet, and he just unplugs his computer and doesn't even think about it, and doesn't realize, like, wait, I have to actually sign something so that Alice gets her money. Then one of them can go to Olivia and say, hey, Olivia, sign. The problem, of course, is it's sunny, and then Alice tells Olivia, hey, it's Alice, say that it's raining, and I'll give you 0.8 coins, right? Because I'm going to lose. I've got nothing at stake here. But if you sign that it's raining, I'll get the whole coin, and I'll give you most of it. So now the Oracle's like, it's a pretty good bribe for the Oracle. That's worth a lot of money. So this is not a... This is doable, right? But you really have to trust the Oracle in this kind of a situation. You might be able to say, okay, well, let's add more keys. Let's add two Oracles. Maybe. But it's a little...
She has to tell Olivia, not Alice.
Alice tells Olivia. Alice goes to the Oracle, like, yeah, let's sign this.
Hey, Alice.
Oh, hey, it's Alice. Yeah, hey, Alice. Yeah, that's a little... hey, Alice. Okay, so the problem is it's interactive, right? It'd be nicer if the Oracle wasn't, like, individually signing things. So the Oracle, in this case, doesn't just see the contract. They decide the outcome, and they can equivocate. So they can say it's sunny over here, and they can say it's raining over here, and they're just signing. So there's nothing really holding them to stick with one, current actual event. So it'd be better if the Oracle couldn't equivocate, and even better if they never saw the contracts. And even better if nobody ever saw the contracts. But how? Okay, so now we're going into some fun math stuff. And I'm not an expert on this, although I'm studying it a lot now. And it's really cool, and it's like somewhat inaccessible because there's not a lot of good documentation. So I try to explain it, and sometimes, like at MIT, students are like, whoa, I never got that, cool, thanks. So hopefully people will get, I'll spend a little time on this and you can get the idea. So I'm not going to go into like how elliptic curves work. I'm just going to say, here's what they do. You don't need to use elliptic curves. You can do the same thing with like regular modular exponentiation in like private fields. But in Bitcoin and Ethereum and most of these systems, we do use elliptic curves. So there's not too much you need to know about these things. The basic idea is you've got regular old numbers, which we call scalars. So from now on, if I use lowercase a and b, that's just a number. And in your computer, it's usually 32 bytes. It's usually modulo some big prime number that's around 2 to the 256. So when you add two 32-byte numbers, you still get a 32-byte number. It's not 30. It's not 257 bits. You don't get an overflow. And when you multiply them as well, you still stay at the same size. So these are easy. These are regular numbers. And then you've got uppercase letters, which are points on a curve, that have different properties. So they're just sort of two types we're dealing with here. Regular numbers, you know, U8 256s essentially, and then points on a curve. So what operations can we do? So scalars, regular unloaded numbers, do whatever you want. Add, subtract, multiply, divide, easy, super fast. Intuitive. If you work with numbers, you know how this works. Points have addition defined, but not multiplication or division. So you can add 2 points, and you can subtract 2 points, but you cannot multiply or divide them. It's just not defined, right? So if you have, you know, and if you look sort of, there's sort of graphic analogies. In practice, it's all like modulo these things, and so it doesn't really look right, but to add 2 points, you sort of take the line between them and see where else that intersects the curve, and then flip over the x-axis. But it's just not defined here. We don't know. It's a group, so there's a single operation. Okay, so we can do these things. And then you can mix these things. So a point plus a regular number. So you say, okay, I've got this point on a curve. I want to add 10. So a plus 10. It's just not defined. It's like, well, what do you mean? It's a type error. You need to somehow cast b to a point. You know, like, you're doing the wrong thing here. It doesn't work. So there's no defined operation there. However, this actually works, which maybe not as obvious, because they do seem to be two different types, and usually you can't multiply two completely different types. But in this case, you say, I've got point A, I want to multiply it by 10. Okay, well, what that means, since addition for these points is defined, it just means A plus A plus A plus A 10 times. So that's how we define multiplication and division. Well, you do a little, it's a little different than actually dividing, but you have the multiplicative inverse modulo the order. But anyway, so you can do this, right? And then it's not too counterintuitive. It's like, I want 10 of this point. Okay, add this point to itself 10 times. And there's fast ways to do it on the computer. Everything's an integer. Everything's modulo some big prime number. This is the most costly operation in terms of CPU time, because, so like when you're syncing Bitcoin, probably this operation is where it's spending the majority of the CPU time, I think, multiplying a point by a scalar. Because also these scalars are really huge, right? They're like on the order of 2 to the 256. And so you have to do a lot of CPU time for that. Anyway, so you can do these things. So here's our sort of toolkit. Here's our roster of operations we can do. We can do the regular boring stuff with numbers, obviously. And then we've got these things we can do. We can add points, and subtract points, and multiply points by scalars. And that's all and what's really cool is that, like, just this lets you do kind of awesome, amazing things. So, like, almost, like, most of the cryptography new stuff that's coming out, so if you've heard of bullet proofs, which is probably, like, you know, one of the frontier sort of, like, super out there, range proofs, and does all these things, it just uses this, right? It uses this and hash functions, which I hope people know about, and I'll use without necessarily explaining them too much. But basically, you have this sort of discrete log toolkit, and, you know, the random oracle model and the discrete log toolkit, and you can do a lot of really cool stuff. The random oracle, we're pretty sure, is here to stay. If ever anyone makes a quantum computer, these go away, and then we'll be stuck without it, and we won't be able to do as many fun things, but hopefully that doesn't happen anytime soon. Okay, so you can do this. So now I will explain. Oh, yeah, and then we also have G. Usually the curves have some kind of generator point where everyone just picks a point on the curve and says, okay, this is G, and we all agree on it, and that's just, and we're going to use that for different operations. Sometimes you also have an H, which is another point like G where people just pick one and use it. Okay, so what we want to do, smart contracts in a channel construction like Lightning. In Lightning, the most recent transaction is valid, and in discrete log contracts, what we want is a non-interactive oracle to determine what's valid. So we're going to use a new type of signature, which is basically a Schnorr signature, but a little different. Okay, so a Schnorr signature, which is much simpler than ECDSA, and I think, you know, it's basically just this equation. ECDSA, if you've tried to like look through the programming of how actual signatures are implemented in Bitcoin or Ethereum and things, it's this algorithm called ECDSA, which is a little weird. It was made weird on purpose so that it would not infringe on the patent for this super complex equation. I think patenting this is kind of silly because it's like, come on. Actually, when I was researching this stuff last year, I I came at it the other way. I wrote my own crazy signature algorithm, which had like an extra coefficient in front of K and all this other stuff going on, and then was talking to people at MIT about it, and then they were like, okay, yeah, I guess this works, but it seems really weird. And then afterwards, I'm like, oh, wait, this is just a Schnorr signature. You can get rid of all this other like extra stuff. It's just a Schnorr signature. Because it's sort of the most obvious, like intuitive. If you've got the discrete log and you've got, you know, Fiat-Shamir transform, you sort of come up with this. But this Klaus Schnorr guy came up with the first, patented it, and so we've been using it for 20 years. So instead we had ECDSA. But now the patent's expired, so we can actually start making progress and using this. And it's nice.
I'm just
Okay, so, and it's also, I think, why in like Bitcoin and some other places, we don't really want to call it Schnorr signatures when we get in. We're going to call it something else because, like, don't give the guy credit, right? Okay, so the idea is you've got your public key. And so public keys in this system is you just come up with a random number, little a, multiply it by g. The resulting big A is your public key. And from big A, no one can figure out what little a is, because that would be G divided by big A, right? But division's not defined for 2 points. So it's not guess and check, right? There are more efficient algorithms than just trying all the possible A's times G to find it, but it's still really hard.
It's defined, but it's expensive.
It's, yeah, there's... But yeah, it'll take you a long time, so you're not going to need it. Okay, so... Then for a signature, you also come up with essentially another private key, call it K, and do the same operation where you multiply this other private key, this nonce K times G, and get what's essentially another public key, R. These are the same types, they're created the same way, but we call this a public key, and we generally call this like a nonce, because it's used once. And then the signer computes S, which is K minus the hash of your message concatenated with that R you just calculated, times your private key. Initially, the initial paper, you didn't have to have a message at all. You could just, this would just be a non-interactive proof that you know your private key without revealing it to someone. But then you can stick a message in there and sign the message.
What is the K?
K is just another random number, right? So little a is a random number, your private key. K is also a random number you come up with at signing time. This you come up with first and tell everyone, and this you come up with at signing time. In practice, it's usually, there's like RFC 6979, so you like deterministically figure out K, but it's a random. Okay, so then your signature is this R point and this S scalar, right? So this is a 32-byte random, you know, number-looking thing, and this is a point on a curve, which is sort of 64 bytes, but it's sort of 33 because you can encode, because it's symmetric, so you can just encode a single bit for the y-axis, for the y-coordinate. So now this is most, what's interesting about this is there's no elliptic curve operations, right? It's, well, you got to calculate R, but you got this random number you came up with, you perform a hash, you multiply the result of that hash times your private key, and then you subtract that from this other random number. All of those are scalar only, really, and so they're very quick. They're not actually doing any elliptic curve stuff here. To verify, so the verifier knows R, S, M, and big A. Right? They don't know K, they don't know little a. But what they can do is they can multiply both sides of this equation by G. So if you multiply both sides by G, you get SG equals KG minus hash of whatever times A times G. And what's nice is, hey, K times G is R, little a times G is big A. They know the whole thing now, right? So they can verify both sides. You know, they multiply both sides. They can verify the both sides multiplied by G thing. And if this is true, then this must be true. And so that's how you can verify a signature without knowing all the private information. Okay, so this works. There's all sorts of cool stuff you can extend from this. But I'm going to change it a little for discrete log contracts. So instead of saying A is my pub key and then my signature is R and S, I'm going to say my pub key is A and R and my signature is S. So it's the same equation, same basic thing, except that when I first make my public key, I sort of make two public keys, publish both of them. And then I don't make this K value at signing time. I've already determined it. I already know what it is. But otherwise it's the same, and I'm just sort of switching where things are. The reason you usually don't do this is because this means you can only sign once. And I will show you why. Okay. So if you sign twice with the same K value and the same little, you know, your same private key, your same nonce, but different messages, what you're going to get is two different S values, right? S1 and S2, because you've got M1 and M2. And so these hashes, you could say like H1 and H2, they're going to be different. So you got different coefficients times your private key, but K is the same. And so if you subtract, so if the attacker, it's not even much of an attack, if you sign twice and then someone says, okay, I've got these two signatures, I just subtract these two signatures. And that's going to be K minus this, minus K minus this. Well, the K's get canceled out. There's no more K anymore. So you just have these two hashes times your private key, right? Hash 1 times A minus hash 2 times A. The thing is, you know, like the attacker knows what these hashes are. So these are, it's two equations, two unknowns, right? You've got a pretty clear way to solve for A. You know everything here. You know S1, you know S2, you know this hash, you know you can factor out A. You know this hash, you know that other hash. You're good. This is real quick on the computer. You can figure out their private key like instantly. Also, fun fact, this is what brought down PlayStation 3's code signing in 2011, I think? Because I think probably Sony engineers read some documentation and said, okay, K needs to be random. And they came up with a random number and set that to be K, and they just left it there. And it stayed that random number for all of their code signing. They use ECDSA, but it's the same, the equation's a little different, but you can do the same thing. They're similar, like, basically they got to ECDSA by, like, tweaking Schnorr until lawyers said, like, yeah, that's not the same thing. Okay, so usually you don't want to do this, right? Usually you don't want to do this switch because, like, well, total data is the same, right? Your public key is like 33 bytes and then your signature is like 64-ish bytes. And this would just be switching, you know, moving stuff around. You're not actually saving any space. You're not doing anything that useful. And now you can only sign once with each public key. That's not cool. Given one of these new public keys, A, R, and a message M, you obviously can't compute their signature, right? You can't compute S. But you can compute S times G, right? Because the whole idea of the verification equation is you multiply both sides by G, and then you know what's on the other side, right? On the other side, it's R times this hash times their public key. Well, if you know what R is before the signature occurs, you can compute this for any message you want to plug in there, right? You know their public key. You know their public key. They've given you R, and you can guess whatever message you want and say, okay, I can't forge one of their signatures, but I can come up with like what their signature looks like for any given message, right? So I can come up with S times G for any message they may sign, and then when they do sign, that'll be S. So SG is computable for any message you want. This is useful because it's an unknown scalar. You don't know S, but you do know S times G. It's like, this is basically the same as a public key and private key, right? Where if someone gives you a public key, okay, you know that it's some private key times G, but you don't know their private key. This is the same thing, where now you can compute these public keys that the signature will be the private key for. So we can use it for a third-party oracle to sign messages and then reveal a private key. So the oracle then says, okay, well, here's my public key. Also, here's an R value that I'm going to use to sign a message, like the weather tomorrow. So now you can compute, okay, well, if the message is sunny, we know what S times G is. We know the point on the curve that corresponds to sunny. If the message is rainy, we know what the point on the curve for rainy is. And now we can use those as public keys and like send money to those places or use it in a multisig script or contract or something. And now when the oracle signs, that will reveal the private key. Okay, so in Lightning, the basic idea is you're revoking old states by revealing a private key, right? The idea in discrete log contracts is you build the entire set of transactions at the start. So instead of saying like, okay, sequentially, we've got this balance, now we update to the next balance, we say, okay, at the very beginning of the contract, we build the entire set of everything that could possibly happen. So if it's sunny, Bob wins. If it's rainy, Alice wins. And then we have this middle one. If it's cloudy, well, we both get our money back or something. And then based on the Oracle signature, one of these states becomes broadcastable. Right, so it's sort of the opposite. Whereas in Lightning, you reveal a private key, and now that becomes like a hot potato transaction that you don't want to broadcast. You do the opposite. Where in this, okay, now we know the private key, so I can immediately, you know, I can broadcast this and immediately grab the output. Right, so the script in this case would be it's the same script, right? The script is basically key A or key B, and you have to wait. Whereas in Lightning, wait, I think I have this. Yeah, so. Yeah, key R or pub, you know, pub R or pub T in time. So in Lightning, the idea is this is the revocation key. And you can take two keys and add them together to make this one. So it's like Alice's key plus something that Bob revealed to them. Or a time-based public key and time has to pass. Right? So you use check sequence verify or op check lock time verify. So in Lightning, the correct use is the timeout. Right? So the idea is I close my own channel and then I have to wait. And that waiting period is giving my counterparty time to contest it and say, no, wait, you broadcast the wrong one. I know the key. I know this key. I can take it immediately while you have to wait. So give someone the option to, like, you know, enforce that. So in the case of the fraud, yeah, revocable key is used. However, in discrete log contracts, it's inverted in that the correct, you know, the timeout case is incorrect when someone publishes the wrong transaction. The idea is if you're publishing the right thing, you're doing the right thing, you don't have to wait at all. You broadcast, you've got the Oracle's key, you've got the Oracle signature, which you use as a private key, add it to your own private key, and you can immediately sweep the funds. So this is actually kind of a nicer property. Because in Lightning, you have to watch for fraud. Like, if old states can be broadcast, then you have to defend against those and use your keys to grab the money. In discrete log contracts, on the other hand, you sweep the output as soon as you broadcast it, which is really nice. And if you go offline, I don't want to say no risk. I think there's no risk. There's no way you can get in trouble, because if you go offline, the only thing your counterparty can do is broadcast the wrong thing. If they broadcast the wrong thing, they'll just never be able to spend it, and you will have to wait to spend it. So there's like an attack where... No surprises. Where can I... I can show... Yeah, so... What you could do, let's say this is it rains, right? And Alice is going to win. And Bob's a jerk. And Bob says, well, I'm going to just broadcast this one where I get 9 coins. And then Alice is like, Alice gets the 1 coin immediately. Bob gets the, you know, it looks like Bob's 9 coins, but Bob just doesn't have the key to spend these. And after a day or two, Alice can spend these. So Alice actually gets a little bit more, right? In this case, Alice gets all 10 instead of the 9 that she should win. But maybe Bob does that because he's like, well, I'm losing everything anyway. You know, if this was like 0.001 or something, and this was 9.999, then Bob might be like, well, I'd rather just be a jerk and tie Alice's funds up for a day or two than get this extra couple Satoshis. So that's one issue, which is why I think it makes sense to like have some payout going to both parties no matter what. Because if you really make it totally, you know, zero here, then Bob has no reason not to just be a jerk and broadcast the wrong thing. But all you can do by broadcasting the wrong thing is delay your counterparty, which is nicer. Because in Lightning, it is possible to potentially rip off your counterparty if they're not aware. Whereas in this case, you know, if you go offline, go on vacation for a month, Bob broadcasts the wrong thing, okay, fine, whatever. As soon as you get back, everything's valid for you to spend. Okay, yeah. How long?
Going, man.
Okay. So the other fun thing for scalability is you can make a discrete log contract within a channel. So, and if you cooperate in this case, then zero transactions get broadcast to the blockchain. I got rid of the slides. Oh, okay. Well, I have this whole thing. Well, yeah, because I probably was thinking, oh shoot, this is going to take forever, and then I get the slides. But the idea is you make an output, sort of like in Lightning channels when you have like a third output, which is an HTLC, not just the two balances for the two parties. You make a third output, which is another 2 of 2 multisig output, and then that is the contract. And then you build all the transactions from that contract, which if you wanted to, you could broadcast, right? You could close the channel, broadcast the transactions from the contract itself, and close everything. But if you're cooperative, you can say, hey, look, you know it was Sunny, you know I can broadcast this and take the money. Let's just get rid of this entire output and, you know, update our balances. And we could have potentially a whole bunch of different discrete log contracts within a single Lightning channel. And we can, like, create them, destroy them, without broadcasting anything. So only when someone's offline or uncooperative, that's when you broadcast the whole thing. And it can get a little messy and can be kind of a big transaction. But it's that backup's always there. So that's a nice property. Other scalability things. So I was talking about like weather, but in general, I don't think weather betting is like a super popular pastime for most people. You guys know this ecosystem. What do you think people will use this for? I don't know, some ideas. What do you?
Security.
Insurance. You can bet people stuff.
Speculation.
Yeah. I mean, sports gambling, maybe. I think one of the big use cases.
Complex derivatives.
Complexity of derivatives. Yes.
Weather futures are actually really good.
Okay. Sure. Weather's a good example, but because there's only three states. What I think will happen is that people will bet on the price of things, right? Where like, hey, I want a Bitcoin settled Dogecoin future, where like the price of Dogecoin determines how many Bitcoins I get at the end of this futures contract, or something like that. More likely you'll have some kind of real world thing like a dollar, where I want $10,000 worth of Bitcoin at the end of this contract. So if the price of Bitcoin goes up, I get fewer of them. If the price of Bitcoin goes down, I get more of them. So I have Bitcoin, but I'm not really exposed to the price difference. And then whoever takes the other side of that is saying, I want these like crazy, super volatile Bitcoins, where like it's like Bitcoin, but even more volatile. But there will be people who want that, because like all these exchanges have like 20x leverage, and people go for it. So I think that's a market that you could make. It's like there's lots of interesting economics, but in general, I think there will be a lot of cases where you want a whole lot of possible messages, right? So if you're betting on the price of oil, and it's like $50 a barrel, well, maybe you're round to the nearest cent, and so there's potentially like thousands of possible prices, thousands of possible messages the Oracle can sign. Because the Oracle says, I'm gonna sign, you know, the closing price of West Texas Intermediate on Friday, or whatever. And there's a lot of possible outcomes there, and you need to build them all into this contract. You don't want the Oracle to sign something you didn't anticipate, and then your contract's stuck, right? So you can probably have some kind of timeout from this, where if the Oracle signs something crazy you didn't anticipate, or the Oracle just disappears, well, maybe both parties get their money back after a few weeks or something. But in general, you want to anticipate lots of things. And people like the ability to have like high resolution things. So it's pretty scalable in that, let's say you've got 1,000 different outcomes. Each signature is only 64 bytes, and then there's a couple dozen bytes of extra data, but I think it's like 100 bytes per transaction, not even, that you have to store. So like 1,000's like whatever, it's 100K. Even 1,000,000, it's like, okay, 100 megabytes, you can do that. Because only one of them actually goes on chain. So 100 megabytes is annoying because you're sending a ton of data and like verifying 1,000,000 signatures, and it takes a while. But if it's a lot of money involved, and you know, it's like people betting millions of dollars, sure, wait a few minutes on your computer. It's doable. But you want to help scalability of that. So one idea is, and I haven't implemented, I sort of implemented a little, split the R value, sort of split the message being signed into two parts, like an exponent and a mantissa. So if you know how floating point numbers work, you're basically, it's like scientific notation where you've got, mantissa is a fancy word for the part that's not the exponent, the thing after the decimal point. And so you could say, okay, well, I'm going to report the price of oil, but I'm going to report it as, if it's, you know, $51.23, I'm going to report it as 5.123 times 10 to the 2, right? And then if it's $103, I'm going to say 1.03 times 10 to the, no, 10 to the 2 is 100, sorry. Anyway,
but,
yeah, so that would be, I think that's like a little overkill. Because there's a trade-off where, like, okay, now I have, like, 32 signatures. But yeah, you can do that, too. You can sign every... You can do binary decomposition and sign each bit, so there's only one thing, and you can add... but then you have more signatures. So in some cases, that's good. In some cases, just splitting in half gets you most of the way there. But then the idea is there's a lot of states where you don't really care as much. So, for example, if we're betting on the price of oil, it might be that if the price is 40 or lower, Alice just gets everything. And if the price is 90 or higher, Bob just gets everything. So in that case, we can say, look, if the exponent is 2 or 3 or 4 or 5, Bob just wins. And if the exponent is 0, Alice just wins. And we don't need to use the mantissa there. So we can cover like a really large range of possible outcomes with only a couple signatures. So that helps. And I think it seems like a little bit, okay, over-optimizing if you're like, you know, doing every bit or things like that, but it might let you do really cool stuff. Because then you could say, well, I'm gonna take the price of oil and also, you know, add in another dimension to this contract. So it's the price, you know, the price of oil has to go up and the price of gold has to go down. Or like, I only have two oracles, one signing the price of oil, one signing the price of gold, but I can create a composite synthetic asset from these two things. But it blows up the number of signatures I need to make because now I'm like on two axes. So you also want to do these kinds of things to keep the number of signatures down. So that's cool. Multi-oracle is also doable. So if you're worried your oracle will lie, and so this, I should caveat here. The oracle can still lie, right? The oracle can't really equivocate in that if they say, oh, the price is $53. Actually, the price is, you know, $54. If they say both of those, anyone can now compute their private key. So if they want to, sort of, they can put up a bounty too and say, hey, here's a bunch of money on this key. And if I equivocate, if I sign two things the wrong way, then anyone can just grab this money from me. So that's nice, but they can lie. They can just say, oh, well, the price of oil is 1 cent. And they can also enter into contracts with people, right? So they could enter into a contract where they're short oil, report the price of oil to be 1 cent, and take a bunch of the money. So you do still trust these oracles to say the right thing. But hopefully they're sort of hands-off enough. They're like far enough away that like it's Bloomberg just signing things. You're not too worried about it. And also they have no idea what you're doing. Right, you're just grabbing these, you know, grabbing their public keys, finding out their signatures, and on the slide. Once the signature is added in to your key pair, you can't see it, right? So these, when these show up on the blockchain, they just look like random public keys. The oracle themselves cannot see that their signature went into any of this, and it's the same script as Lightning, so you can't distinguish it between, was this a Lightning channel that closed or was this a discrete log contract. Looks the same. Although, sort of an asterisk, the very common case in this will be the non-timeout clause of the script, and in Lightning that's very rare. So you'll be able to guess, right? It was either a Lightning network channel that closed fraudulently or a discrete log contract channel, like contract that closed correctly, or the opposite, right? So you can get an idea, but not too much. So you can do multiple oracles, right? You can say, okay, I'm going to use Oracle A, Oracle B, I just add their points and get a third point, and I can use that as the point I add to my own for this. So for N of N, no size increases. For N of M, where M is greater than N, then you do have a size low. So, but if it's just 2 of 2, no problem. Well, there's always problems. The problem is, what if they're a little bit off? So like one oracle reports that the price is, you know, $53.23, the other report is $53.27, you're like, oh shoot, well, we didn't have, you know, we didn't have like all these different like close signatures, we just, you know, used the same signature for both and now we're stuck. So that's another time where you can use this, where you say, okay, well, we have two oracles, one of them we actually care about the mantissa, the other one's just there to double check the exponent to make sure we're like not totally off. So as long as Bloomberg and Thomson Reuters are within, you know, 20% of each other, we're going to go with Bloomberg. So we're protected against things that are like way off. If some oracle gets compromised and reports that the price is 1 cent, then the contract fails and we just get our money back. So you can combine them and make it safer that way. Okay, so I think towards the end. What are the use cases? Currency futures, stocks, commodities, sports, insurance. I think there's a lot of things you can do. I think this one will be big, because already you've got like CME's doing Bitcoin futures where it's, you don't get any Bitcoin, but you get a bunch of dollars based on the price of Bitcoin, right? So I want, you know, 10 Bitcoins worth of US dollars on Friday. And those exist, those are being settled and executed now. This could do the opposite, where you could say, I want, I already said it. I want $10,000 worth of Bitcoin on Friday. And so I'm not exposed as much to the price, but I still get this. That said, depending on the collateral in the contract, it can break, right? So if there's, let's see. If there's 20 coins in the contract, right? We each put 10 in, and then I say, I want $100,000 at the end of the week. And then the price of Bitcoin drops to like 50 bucks. Well, I can get all 20 coins, but it's not going to get me to 100K, right? So, and if you collateralize it symmetrically, where both parties put in equal amounts, then you can survive up to like a drop of 50% of the price of Bitcoin. The price of Bitcoin in whatever asset you're trading. So it could also be like, I'm investing in gold, and then gold just skyrockets and goes up 10x in a week. And you're like, oh, well, I get all the Bitcoins, but that still doesn't quite get me to the full value of the asset I thought I was getting. So there's limits, right? But I think in general works. The other big limit is it's fully collateralized. So if you talk to Wall Street people, they're like, this is stupid because you have to put all your money into the contract at the beginning. Like, all I do is leverage everything. Like, you know. feature versus bug, I don't know. Maybe a lot of people think that the excessive leverage in the current financial system is a bug, or maybe it's a feature. So in this case, it's really hard to get around that, because the idea here is your counterparties are anonymous. You don't trust your counterparty at all. And so it's real hard to have any kind of concept of debt or margin calls or things like that in a system like that. But I still think it's useful. And also, collateralization could be a problem long term, but right now, Bitcoin doesn't do anything in that, like, you can't really get an interest rate on it, really. Most of it just sort of sits there. So the fact that you need to, like, lock up your Bitcoin in one of these contracts for a while, well, what else are you going to do with it? I mean, you know.
Feature or bug?
What?
Feature or bug?
Yeah, I mean, you know, it's cheaper than, like, you know, putting dollars. If you have to collateralize something with dollars and you're not getting any interest off of it, that's like a real cost. But right now, people aren't really making a return on Bitcoin, at least in Bitcoin terms. So we'll see. You know how. And then also, you don't have leverage, but you can crank up the like sort of payout ratio. So you can say, like, look, if the price goes up 5%, I win everything. And if the price goes down 5%, you win everything. So you can sort of narrow down the range where it works. Okay, so yeah. There's lots of fun things you can do with this. So in terms of practical, like the MIT DCI people, we're working on an implementation. It's on GitHub, so if you go github.com/MITDCI, it's in Lit, the sort of Lightning Network wallet code base I'm working on. There's sort of a UI, there's sort of like three UIs, one of them's actively being worked on. UIs are always tricky. But yeah, we're working on it. It's all just open source, so it's some MIT people working on it. So if you want to like look at it and you know contribute, awesome. If you want to just like grab it and use it for your own project, you can do that because it's MIT licensed. The MIT license, not licensed to MIT. But just you know, you just keep the same copyright and work on it, and maybe we can take the code improvements you do back. So I think this is kind of fun. It can work on, you know, whatever has SegWit. You could probably adapt this to things like Ethereum, right? You could make a pretty straightforward little smart contract that's just the essentially script output that Lightning channels use, which is basically this key or this other key and wait. And you could make fairly, you know, so like, because the Ethereum EVM is in some ways like a, you know, superset of what the Bitcoin script can do. So you could take this script, which is really, you know, 10 opcodes or something, and then port this to EVM, and then have like these kind of smart contracts on Ethereum or something like that. And then keep the same anonymity and the same properties. So that might be useful. There might be a little weird. You could do it in Ethereum. And, you know, it's a nice property to have that, like, you could use the same oracles, you know, so one oracle, all they're doing is signing messages, and they're just reporting these 32-byte little signatures, and you could use that in EVM, you could use that in Bitcoin, you could use that in Zcash, you know, you could use that in pretty much anywhere you have a script, and potentially places where you don't have a script. So, like if the research Andrew Polster is doing on sort of scriptless scripts, where something like Mimblewimble, where there's only public keys, can we try to like squish all these functions into just a signature itself? And this is, you know, in that vein where all you're doing, you know, you've got this entire smart contract that sort of condenses down into just a signature, and potentially even more. So there's still tons of like research to do on it, still tons of implementation, but it looks fun, and hopefully people will be using it at some point in the future, and maybe they'll do like dollar currency futures instead of Tether, or they'll do, you know, trustless betting instead of, you know, depositing all their money into some centralized thing and betting that way. So, okay, sounds good. Do people have questions? Or, yeah.
How do you imagine, what incentive does Oracle have for publishing and stuff? What incentive does Oracle have to publish?
Oh, incentive, yeah. So, one of the issues is that, like, the Oracle has no idea who's using these signatures, and so it's very difficult for them to get paid. So there's two... So, like, I agree it's, like, sort of a problem. I think there's two things that make it not so bad. For the price of Bitcoin, or the price of dollars, however you want to look at it, I think that that exchanges have a good incentive to report their own prices. So like if Gemini says, hey, we're gonna sign off on the like, you know, 1 hour volume weight, or they have like that auction every day, and they publish that. I think it makes sense for them to publish a discrete log signature, you know, discrete log contract signature for that as well, because if everyone's using your data feed, that could potentially push users onto your platform, because they wanna hedge it out. They're like, well, I can hedge out perfectly because I know this, you know, it'll be the same prices on the exchange. So that's potentially one. The other, from what I've talked to, it's kind of silly, but like blockchain technology, so there's lots of institutions. Like if you talk to Bloomberg, they're like, that sounds cool, we could do that. Or like Fidelity, or like, you know, companies are like, we could do that. And it's not expensive, right? They already have all the data. It's just sign it. So it may initially anyway be like a companies thinking it's like a cool blockchain technology thing and we're going to be an Oracle. They're not getting paid directly, but it's also not too costly, and you know, reputation's like huge in this as well. So I think, at least for exchanges, it's pretty easy. Because if I trust an exchange to hold my money, I can definitely trust them to at least report what the prices are. So I think that'll be one of the first use cases.
Do you need two data feeds? Like all the nonces, all the signatures?
So the sort of nonces, pub keys, that comes at the beginning. They can pre-commit to everything. They can say, okay, here's my public key, and here's the R I will use every day for the next year.
It's like one big dump.
Yeah, that what they can do. I still am trying to work on like maybe you can condense that and have some kind of weird function where they only have to commit to a little bit, and then the users can generate the R values. But I don't think
just based on the date or answer.
I think it's impossible, but I don't have a. I'm still like, everything I've come up with, and I'm like, oh, this works. And then I'm like, wait, it works for three, you know, and you can do it twice, but if you do it three times, then it reveals the key.
There's where
I do it. Mm-hmm. Okay, we should, yeah. Oh.
So
okay.
In the combination of multiple pieces thing, is it possible for the Oracle to essentially express a number in like binary and
yep.
for people to agree to a threshold thing?
You were just saying that too. Yeah, you can decompose the entire number into each bit, and then you say, okay, well, I've got a R value for each bit I'm gonna sign. So I have 32 R values, I'm gonna, you know, sign a 32-bit integer, and then I'll just sign each bit individually and provide a signature for each. And then we can combine and add those however we want. And we can get rid of like low bits, we can get rid of high bits. So we could say, I bet that this value is odd, and so we're just only using the lowest bit as one or something. So you can do that,
it's a question of whether you can support thresholding. So we want something where you're going to publish some value in binary, and we want it to be that I can make a signature that works if you publish a value greater than or equal to blah.
You can do that.
The verb works, you just do
it. Yeah, you just do, well.
Without doing every combination.
Basically, you can say like, If it's like a really, I mean, the easiest way is like, I'm signing a value between 0 and 255. Okay, well, the threshold is 128, and I just signed the most significant bit as 1, and then you can do it that way. So there's like ugly ways to do it like that. There's other weird threshold things you can do, but a lot of them are interactive, and they need the oracle to support it, or the multiple oracles to do it, and so it's harder. But like, to some extent, you can sort of solve any problem by just throwing more pre-computed states. Like the two parties can pre-compute anything.
You know what, I think if you're actually doing every case, you only need to do log n.
Yeah. You can. So it's like not too bad. And also, you can do a bunch of, like, they're pretty fast and pretty small. So like, and they don't go on chain. So it's like, well, even if you have to do like 100,000 or a million, like it's annoying and slow, but you can do it. So.
It could be hard to federate that, though.
Yeah.
I was wondering what you think are the biggest restrictions of the system like has, and also where you think it could evolve to, like,
Restriction and evolution. So,
like, because I feel like it's like Ethereum smart contracts, is, like, they're so open and you can do you can create data structures and stuff, but these smart contracts kind of
These are more limited. These are move money based on I haven't thought about like or I haven't the direction I'm going is not like we need to make it support like the entire EVM. It's like that's kind of harder. The other thing that would be cool. Right now, the problem is you're sort of stuck in it for the duration of the contract. You want novation. Novation would be very useful where you could say, okay, Alice and Bob are in a contract. Alice wants out. Bob doesn't. Bob can just not respond. But Alice says, okay, hey, Bob, Carol is taking my place. So from Bob's perspective, the contract stays the same. The only thing that changes is the pub keys of the counterparty. And so Bob's perspective is, yeah, whatever, I'm in the same contract. And then Bob's computer can, it's still interactive in that Bob has to sign, but Bob's computer can do that automatically because there's no real, decision-making involved. Even better would be if it was completely non-interactive and you could sort of get rid of your position without Bob's doing anything. And then another cool thing, which I don't know how to do, is, if you've got these contracts in a channel, can you somehow let other people in different channels participate in your contracts? Going to do it, maybe. That would be even cooler because then you can say, look, I'm going to sell you my position in this contract. Because in many futures markets and options markets and stuff, that's how they work, where you're in a futures contract and you don't hold it until it expires and then it settles. A lot of times you swap it back and forth a whole bunch of times before that happens. And so this, it's possible, it's possible with interactivity, but it's not implemented, and it looks a little annoying to implement because it's like, now it's three computers talking to each other instead of just two. So those are some of the things I'm looking at in the future. But I still think it's more sticks to moves money based on external data, not so much make an ERC-20 token or play poker or chess for money. Maybe you can adapt something like this to it, but I still think this covers a lot of the use, right? So. That's what I'm thinking. Any other questions? One more? No.
Just one more.
It's almost 10. Yeah. Oh, yeah.
What makes you excited about the future?
I'm excited about the future. There's lots of fun things. This stuff's actually working. There's lots of cool math. The fun thing I like is it seems like there's still not that many people working on these things in that, you can find new things out. I'm not a crypto expert or anything, and as far as I know, no one's written this before. And it's I've talked to people who are professors of cryptography, and they're like, oh, cool, yeah, that works, I get it. It's just you move the R, oh, okay, cool, yeah, that's nice. And it's just I came up with something, hey, cool. I'm working on another thing this summer with Corey and people, and it's I think this works, cool, this is really cool, and it actually makes things faster and better, and it feels like you can actually get something done. Whereas, it feels like in a lot of jobs I've had, there's not a whole lot of room where maybe you can make something a little better, but you're sort of just working on your thing. Whereas here, it's still new. Even though it's worth a bajillion dollars, supposedly, there's still not too many, I recognize most of the faces here. It's still the same people who have been here from 2014, 2015 for the most part, which is good and bad, right? You want new people getting in. You have some. And so I'm teaching a class at MIT to get lots of new people into this. But at the same time, it's like, it's still not that big, and there's still lots of cool new things you can figure out and build. So that's pretty inspiring, hopeful, I guess. Yeah. Cool.
All right.
Okay, thanks.
Thank you.